Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:03 p.m. Central Time on Friday, October 13th, 2017. Yes, it is Friday the 13th. We're not superstitious. Let me welcome you in here to the Earthquake 3D live stream, where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet, and we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement to strike. So if you're new here, we're looking at the USGS feed, the European EMSC feed, and the GeoNet down here in New Zealand, so we can get a good idea of everything that's going on around the planet. And if we look at the last 24 hours worth of activity since my update last night at 10 p.m., you're going to notice a few things standing out that occurred. Of course, yesterday we had our deep earthquake that was here on our letter D, which the letter D stands for deep earthquakes. That's how frequent they happen there, enough that we can put a letter D on the map and it gets hit over and over again. And this was just one event. Now, today, up here on the Izu Ridge going into Japan, new activity, new deep earthquake striking on the coast of Japan, two of them since yesterday, and on the Izu Ridge here. So really, that's four deep earthquakes in the last 2 days. Now, each of these deep events on their own can cause a shallower, larger earthquake, 1 to 2 magnitudes larger, usually striking in the areas that we call silent zones, the spots usually surrounding the deep earthquake first, then spreading out from there and going around the planet. So new deep earthquakes here, that's the first part of this update. Take a look at it. So it's pretty significant. Then over here, all the way across the Pacific in South Mexico, a new 5.5 to 5.6 earthquake has struck right here in our warned area. They downgraded it to 5.4. Whatever, there it is. Let's get all the others off there. There we go. Okay, and look where it struck, guys. Struck on land. That's within a half magnitude of what we warned for. We warned for a 6.0 and a 5.4 is hit. It's enough to cause damage. It was shake reports around the region. People definitely felt it around the area, and that fulfills the forecast for Mexico so far. That's day 4 of the 7-day forecast. So here we are on Friday. We're taking this through till Monday night into Tuesday. And the spot in Mexico has been hit on land. Now look at the United States. Look what happened here. A new 4.5 struck off the coast of Oregon. And some stations going as high as 5, other stations going down to 3. Now we throw out the low and we throw out the high, and this takes us into upper 4.0 range within about a magnitude and a half of what we're looking for. We're looking for something a little bit larger than this to strike. So far, 4.5. Now look what happened after that. A new 4.0, 3.9 downgrade, struck right north of San Francisco near Geysers and Clear Lake Volcano. Unfortunately, that is also the area just around there that's burning really bad. Interesting. New 4.0 earthquake just struck there on top of the activity off the coast. Now also look what happened in the Midwest. New activity last night. You can see that marked in like a pinkish red color, that 3.1. Get that off there. Look what hit in Kansas. New activity spreading across Kansas, going down into Oklahoma. And we warned for this, talked about it. If you watched my update last night, you need to look for it. And this is just the beginning. I think we're going to be going up a notch in the next few days. Now, why are we going to be going up a notch in the United States? Because there was a 5 and some 4s now that have struck off the West Coast. Also, Southern California, we issued the warning already. I will issue it again right now. Southern California, LA, pumping operations down to the south. We showed you the zone last night. I will show it to you again right now. It's marked with earthquakes. So the earthquakes basically tell us the zone to watch and wait for that to populate. Turn down our rings. And our spot that we watched last night started in Ventura and went down here all the way to Salton Sea. And the halfway point came in here east of LA near Big Bear. That's the halfway point. It should get hit. But look what else happened today, guys. On the northwest edge of the Craton, up here in Idaho, next to Sulphur Peak and Soda Springs. That's a volcano, by the way. Swarming. And then the Northwest Edge. This is the northern part of Yellowstone's magma chamber, believe it or not. See where it goes all the way up into Montana, past Bozeman? The magma chamber for Yellowstone is 11 Grand Canyons in size. It starts here at the park where the surface eruption is due, I guess, where the geyser fields are. And then it spreads out and around Idaho and comes all the way back around in a giant oval shape coming out of Yellowstone going to the west, okay? So just understand, we got a swarm happening on the northern tip of that. Then we get back over here and Mount Rainier is being hit again today. And we are back inside the crater at Mount St. Helens. Yes, let me go pull the coordinates on this and just show it to you. I'll get a display capture turned on so you can see what I see. Okay, and here we go. It's just a little earthquake, but I showed it yesterday. I told you guys, it was spreading around the volcano, right? First we got hit inside the crater, then we were spreading around Mount St. Helens. Well, when you see where this one is, I think it'll make a little bit more sense. So this is how you do it. Even if it's a small earthquake, grab the coordinates from the USGS, put them in, go look it up. It only takes a few seconds, and you'll be surprised. You'll find that there's, well, a reason that the earthquakes are striking here. So here we are. We're right back at Mount St. Helens. And the spot that we were looking at yesterday, okay, here's our new spot. The spot we were looking at yesterday is here, up here. Or I'm sorry, over here. So let's back that out so you can see the relation and how it's moving. It's moving towards and around the volcano. It started inside the dome and it carried on into yesterday inside the dome. Okay, now the other swarm over to the east has died out. So just be aware, again, that swarm up to the north at St. Helens and Rainier carries on. The swarm to the east has died out. Going down into California after these new fours, we can certainly expect a few things to happen. You know what? As I'm talking right now, something has just happened. A new swarm has broken out right where you see this green earthquake. See this? Now I'm going to go pull the coordinates on this, and this makes total sense. I would have normally issued this yet, but now that it's happening, I can't really say it's a forecast. We can expect a swarm at the California-Nevada border each time that there's an earthquake of noteworthy size off the coast. And when I show you what's there, longtime viewers in the chat room will agree. Take a look at this. See this? Volcanic Hills, Butte Volcano, unnamed Volcanic Butte. Back this out ever so slightly. See where we are in relation to, let's say, Aurora Crater and Mud Springs? So longtime viewers, you already know this. Mud Springs and Aurora Crater and Mono Lake all related to one another. But this new location, that's right next to the other location that we are always looking up, is a different volcano. Volcanic Hills Butte. Now, that's a pretty creative name. I didn't name it. Of course, we downloaded these place marks from University of Wyoming. And I guess, you know, when you look at it, it's ancient. But we certainly do have old basalt exposed, igneous rock, lava flows. But it's just massive. It looks like a dike volcano, if you know what those are. So there we go. That's very, very interesting to see a new swarm breaking out there right now as I'm talking. Literally a new 3.0 earthquake hitting. And that's on top of a few others today. So all in all, what can we expect? Southern California, you are going to be getting hit by a 4.5 to 5.0 earthquake. There was a 5.2 and a mid-range 4 that has struck here off the coast of Oregon. It's already pushing down to the south. It's causing a swarm at the California-Nevada border. If you know anybody in Southern California, let them know. LA to Salton Sea, in between the pumping operations, most likely southeast of LA. So right in here at the center point. Over in the Midwest, we have two different things going on. One, we have pressure creeping into Kansas coming in from the west-northwest. Again, our earthquakes up here over the past couple days. And let me get our earthquake feed turned on for the past few days. There we go. This is the last 7-day earthquake feed. Take a look off the coast. Yesterday's 4.5 and today's 4.5. That's on top of the 5.2. Add it all together, it's going to be pushing into the Midwest. Now, two twos is not all we're going to see off this. You can expect a major increase in the Midwest at the pumping ops not just anywhere in the Midwest at the pumping ops, western Oklahoma. See where the 2.5 is? We would look just a little bit south of there since the other two spots have moved. Additionally, Colorado, you're going to get hit again. Now, you guys know I lived out here for a few years out in Denver. And you know what? Right here at the Colorado-New Mexico border, most people don't know there's thousands of oil wells drilled in the backcountry on the mountaintops. And this spot here, where humans have drilled in thousands of times by thousands of feet, is vulnerable. It's like a fracture point or a perforation. So we have to warn the people in Colorado. There's just a new 4.0 and 5.0 push in the past few days. So Southern Colorado is going to get hit, just like it got hit. See that 3.4? See this one? Let me highlight it and turn down the rings. There we go. That was the previous round of activity that hit. Now we have a new one. So be ready for it. And the magnitude is going to be about the same that's down in Southern California. Yes, it'll maintain momentum across the plate. When you get a 4.0 earthquake out here, you see 4.0 activity striking in the Midwest. Now, real quick, we need to consult something else that I think is going to absolutely blow your mind if you've been paying attention to, well, check this out. Look. See this? Now take a look at the last 48 hours. Look. Look at this. It's amazing. The slow slip has picked up in pace. Now, the slow slip is a term to describe when plates are moving side by side. When plates are moving side by side, let's get back over to Earthquake 3D. When the plates are moving side by side, particularly in this location, that's happening on land right now. So we have a cluster up to the northwest, Vancouver Island, and in Olympic Peninsula. Again, take a look at it. Now, the professionals said the slow slip stopped back in April. But longtime viewers and people who watch every night know we've seen clusters like this, hundreds of earthquakes, break out, hundreds of tremors, very small vibrations, breaking out in California, Oregon, Washington, and Vancouver, indicating that the plate has not stopped, and it shouldn't stop. It would be highly abnormal if the plate stopped moving entirely. As a matter of fact, when the plate does stop, it finally will when the slow slip comes to a full halt. I think that's going to be leading to a new earthquake off the coast of significant size, above mid-range 7. I come to that conclusion based upon past slow slip events, but this one's gone on for 9 months, a year. We're getting into the point where back in 2011, here in Japan, there was a slow slip that was happening from Tokyo going up to the coast of Honshu. So about 400 or 500 miles, maybe 600 miles, about the same distance, as a matter of fact, as what's going on here in the United States right now. They had a slow slip going on for about a year to a year and a half. Towards the end of the slow slip, it was accompanied by many larger earthquakes mixed in with all those smaller events. And the larger earthquake started in 4.0 range, went up to 5s, then it topped out at 7.2, 2 days before the big one hit in Japan. So a 7.2 hit in Japan 2 days before the 9.0 hit. And the 7.2 was a part of the slow slip itself. So over in the United States, it's been... Oh, and over in Japan, it went on for about a year to a year and a half, almost 2 years. The slow slip carried on. Now here we are. We're going on 9 months. Well, more than that, 10 months. It started right at the turn of the year. And the professionals talked about it till April, and then they said it stopped. Well, if it stopped, what are we looking at here? It didn't stop. It's still going. And if it's still going, and the professional said it stopped, we've got a problem. Because I'm the only person online talking about it. And what's the threat of it? Well, when it finally does stop, it's going to release with an earthquake somewhere between that 7.5, 7.7 range, the low end that I'm putting on it, and the Japan megaquake. And that's not an exaggeration, but I can't put a time frame on it forecast-wise. When the slow slip starts to stop, I'll see it, and I will tell you, and that's when we start looking for a big release. It could be any time. Once this goes quiet, you see this go quiet for three or four days without any of these events on the map, that's when we start to raise our antenna and worry for the threat of a large earthquake coming out to sea. Okay? And that's no exaggeration on my part. I will be here along with you. And if it starts to happen that way, I'll be the first person on here to tell you about it. And I will carry on that news throughout the day and week that carries on. It won't be that long. Once it starts to go quiet, I don't think it will be more than a few days to a week that you get the big earthquake. Okay, now let's talk about a few others. Take a look at this. Both of our arrows have been hit in the last day by the same sized earthquake, 4.8, 4.9. 2,000 miles apart in the Pacific, within a day of each other, coming across our arrows. Where do the arrows trace back to? Take a look. Traces right back to our letter D, where we had our deep earthquakes, 4.6, a day and a half ago. So the deep earthquakes pushed over to the east and have now caused new shallower earthquakes as the pressure's transferring. I told you guys, pressure transfers across these fracture zones. Do you see these? They go east and west. They look like rungs on a ladder. Well, they transfer pressure across all the way from over here. Imagine it like this. Take a look at the screen. I'm going to turn on a function here. See these domes? Now, I want you to imagine this dome of pressure coming up from down below this deep earthquake. And as it's coming up, it's pushing outwards. And when it pushes outwards, pressure transfers across. And it transfers across the zones that are already broken. When the pressure reaches all the way over to South America, it hits South America like a wall, and it has nowhere to go. So the pressure tries to force itself around and underneath the plate boundary. Now, this is amazing to me that this happens in such a short amount of time. It takes maybe a few days for the pressure to transfer all the way across the plate, hit South America, and then come all the way down to its termination point in the South Atlantic. And that's happening right now. Two near fives have just struck in the last day, indicating pressure coming across. And I think that's why pressure is also increased in Mexico, causing our expected 5.5 to 6.0 earthquake. Let's go watch the forecast for this week. We called for all this to happen in this amount of time. Now let's talk about Europe really quick. How about a new 4.0 earthquake striking here in central Italy? Yeah, a 4 has hit. But to show it to you, let me take it over to the latest data contributions. See this? Central Italy. Look. So whether you go with the INGV, they lowballed it by a half magnitude, or you go with BEO, we trust them, guys. We trust them. Go with BEO. Look at our magnitude list. 3.5, 4.1, 4.0, 4.0, 4.4, 3.8, 3.1. We always throw out the low, and we always throw out the high. So throw out the 4.1, throw out 3.1, and what does that leave us? It leaves us with a 4. So the expected earthquake we were looking for, and shake reports were all over this area. People felt it. So the chances of it being a 3.2, no. It's larger. So there it is. And again, I just showed it to you. You don't have to take my word for it. So a 4 has hit. They did the weird downgrade thing on it again, and we were looking for a 4. So check it off the list. And also check off Iceland off the list. Now, Iceland has been hit right on our letter X with a 3.1. Well, there's no shock there. 3.1 in Iceland after 3.6 in Poland. 3.6 transferred up and across, turned into a 3.1. It lost a little steam trying to go across the whole plate, coming out of Poland and going across the North Sea. And it's going through the bedrock itself, going through the plate. It loses a little bit of power and then resurfaces back at the termination point. Check it off the list. We, again, name that to happen this week. Doesn't happen every week either. You don't see Poland get hit every week with new activity. Only when it's great. And the pressure is coming from one location. It's coming from down here. See our arrows, how they point up and around? Follow the arrows back. And this is where it comes from. Now we're looking for a new 5.0 earthquake to be striking in here. It hasn't hit yet. Should hit in the next day and a half. Wait, hold on. Okay, yeah, hasn't hit yet. We're waiting for it to hit, and now we have a new push coming into Europe. Check out what's coming into you guys. A new 4.6 and 4.4 and 4.3 swarm breaking out in the Gulf of Aden on the backside of the Red Sea. This is Saudi Arabia. And this is going to be coming around and going up into our impact zone, where we're already looking for a 5. So we have a swarm of 4s pushing in with the 5. And it's, I think it's only going to take it up by a point. So it should take it up to a 5.1 maybe instead of a 5. Striking where? Not just anywhere in South Mediterranean. Here between Crete, the little island of Crete, and the little island of Cyprus. So right here. And next 48 hours should tell the tale on this. It's incoming. Imminent. It's going to be coming soon to you. Same with these deep earthquakes. Let's get into Japan. Guys, I've got a lot of viewers in Japan. And some have said just the most thoughtful things to me here at my P.O. box. So if you've missed that, we've done unboxings where people have sent me gifts and letters. And so the people in Japan have really responded well. And I don't take it lightly when I issue a warning. So we have 2 new deep earthquakes, one on the Izu Ridge, one right off the coast of Tokyo. Well, the one off the coast of Tokyo, that alone is capable of causing a 5.1 to 6.1 earthquake. If you add in the deep 4.5 from yesterday on the Izu Ridge, that can cause a 5.5 to 6.5. So if you add these two together, since they struck within 24 hours of each other, we're getting to about a 4.6 deep earthquake, which means it can cause a 5.6 to 6.6 cumulative total between the two deep earthquakes, not just anywhere, most likely in the area east by northeast. So if you go east by northeast from this location following our arrows, it brings us right up here, north of Japan, North Japan, coast of Honshu, Hokkaido, South Kuril Islands. Magnitude, like I said, 5.6 to 6.6 within the next 72 hours. Let's see. Saturday, Sunday, Monday. By Monday night into Tuesday at the latest, this should have happened. So be on watch in North Japan. Secondly, we have a silent zone here in Philippines. Philippines, Taiwan, Okinawa. Philippines, Taiwan, Okinawa, you've already been warned. You have yet to be hit. The magnitude, it's looking like all the others, going to be in that 5-ish range, 5.3. And it looks like it's not going to delay much longer. So we'll go watch the forecast. It's over on my channel. It's still good for several days. We issued it on Tuesday. Today is Friday. And we have till this coming Tuesday. These are just naming the areas that have been hit. If you live in California, or if you live on the west coast of the United States at all, I want you to have an earthquake plan. Same for the people over here in Japan. I want you to have an earthquake plan. Now, most likely you already have one, and you've already heard it 1,000 times, but now we've got a good reason to warn you. You have 2 new deep earthquakes down to your south. You have a silent zone sandwiched in right here. We also need to consult the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. And we need to talk about New Zealand in just a second. But first things first, let's go jump into the volcanoes. We always have to check these. Now, I don't forecast volcanoes. I just tell you guys, you need to look at the volcanic eruptions, because after the eruptions, there's earthquake activity that's accompanying that. So, Aoba volcano in Vanuatu. Also, Kerensky in Russia. That's Kamchatka. Kirishimayama. Awesome video footage coming out of that, by the way. People flying drones over the erupting volcano in Japan. Sabankaya, again, Kirishimayama, Aoba, Dukono, Aoba, Sabankaya, Shivalush, Cinnabung, Reventador. This is all today. Sanjay is back on the list. And anybody else? I mean, the list just goes on and on. Okay, Sakurajima there as well. Let's show you where these are. It makes a lot more sense. Right down here, right where the earthquake is Vanuatu. And that's where Aoba volcano is. Going over to the west, we have Dukono volcano here erupting. Over to the west from there, we have Cinnabung erupting in Indonesia. Up to the north, we have Sakurajima and Kirishimayama both erupting here. And then we go all the way up here, and we get to the Kamchatka Peninsula, which is Shivalush and Kerensky volcanoes. So that is an increase Technically, across the West Pacific, it's the same volcanoes, but each one, that's an increase. But you'll notice something. How about a lack of eruptions over here in the East Pacific entirely? No Popocatépetl, no Fuego, no Turrialba, no Rincon, no Nevados del Ruiz, no Nevados del Chilean. The only ones we have going are Reventador, Sanjay, and Sabancaya. Well, Sanjay's the new one on the list. And look at our big arrow. See the big arrow? Indicating pressure's coming in. What did we talk about watching for? We talked about watching for new eruptions and 5.0 earthquake activity. So the next thing on the list is 5.0 earthquake activity, since a new eruption just happened at Sabancaya and at Reventador and at Sanjay. Okay, so that's South America erupting. Central America stopped. That means earthquake threat. And with the 5.5 hitting, I think this should be a wake-up call to everybody in Mexico that you're looking at coming larger earthquake activity. I told you guys, a month ago, there was an 8.1 earthquake that struck right here. It shifted the plate boundary. I need to show it to you in a different way. Please, look at the screen. If you're from Mexico, I'm not trying to scare you or, you know, trying to get your attention in some weird way, but this is not good. This is no bueno. Take a look. The 8.1 struck right here. I've got it marked September 8th. So just over a month ago it struck. Now when it struck, you see the big cliff that goes and drops off here? Maybe I should bring this in at an angle so you can really understand when we're talking about depth here. Okay, so here we are. We could go down below sea level. See this? See how it's a cliff? Here, we're looking up from the bottom of the Pacific. Isn't that cool? Okay, it's a great way to look at it and try to understand that this is a drop-off that goes down, how far is that? 19,000 feet, 20,000 foot drop-off here. Now, this is where the Pacific plate here, I want you to imagine this like the bottom of a bathtub that meets up to the side wall of a bathtub. And there, it's seamless, just like your bathtub, okay? And it's seamless, but there is a fold down in there. It's been covered by sediment and over time, of course, shifting. Now, this is the plate boundary between the two plates here out to sea where the big depth is. And this shifted 33 feet, 32 feet to the northwest and southeast. That's almost 11 meters. In the 8.1 earthquake. After that shifted to the northwest and southeast, then, like a week and a half later, not even, a new 7.1 earthquake struck on, 10 days later, or 11 days later. 7.1 earthquake struck right here to the northwest, next to Popocatépetl. Then pressure after that shifted all the way up and all the way up. Okay? Now, that's going to happen again. This is going to move again. Why is it going to move again? Well, the old flow and the way pressure normally flows, look at the edge of the craton here. Let me turn off our borders and labels, and you'll be able to see the wavy shape of the plate. Kind of looks like a sideways S or a U shape. And it goes out the Cayman Trench, follows the Cayman Trench out, then goes around Puerto Rico, and takes us out to our fracture zones that extend the pressure out to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. So going back to where the big earthquake struck, right here, on the back side of the Cayman Trench, 33 feet moved, and it's blocked the flow of pressure coming out and going over. And now pressure flows out around and comes over to the east. Now, this brings me into an earthquake that I don't have linked right now. Maybe somebody in chat can bring it up. On the GEMPA feed, G-E-M-P-A, on the GEMPA feed, today reported a 4.0 earthquake off the coast, the east coast of the United States, somewhere out here off the coast of North Carolina and South Carolina somewhere. Now, guys, you know, we issued a warning for the area right here off the coast. going from Florida up to the East Coast. We talked about pressure coming into the Bahamas and looking for a rare earthquake to strike after the 4.0 struck north in Mexico last night. Now, that's not my take on it. That's the GEMPA feed showing a 4.0 earthquake off the coast today. Now, that's, again, it's phenomenal. It's so rare to happen, but there it is right again. You guys have to go look it up. I can't show it to you right before your eyes because I don't have the link. That being said, we're going to see another large earthquake strike here in the next couple weeks. Not even that long. It's not going to take that long. With the new deep earthquakes happening now, and with the fact that earthquakes are now pressing onto land and striking and increasing in magnitude by a full magnitude, that's a power increase of tenfold, I think we're going to carry it on up. I really do, in the next several days going into next week. Finally, there will be another large earthquake that strikes here that breaks that pressure block, if you will. It'll allow the pressure to flow back across the Caribbean. This is the way pressure flows. It will only go around for so long before finally it gets another push. The last one came at a time of deep earthquakes on this side of the Pacific. So we saw deep earthquakes over here happen in a flurry, like 5 or 6 of them, maybe even more, maybe it was 10 of them. And then, boom, 8.0 earthquake hit on this side as compensation for all the pressing up on this side. This side got hit with a shallow earthquake. Bunch of deep earthquakes over here, followed by a big shallow earthquake over here. And it happens like that on a regular basis when you get big deep earthquake events, like what we're starting to see right now. Again, look at the last few days. So it's spread out across about 4,500 miles or 7,000 kilometers from Japan all the way down to Fiji. So imagine the force that it takes to push up on the underside of the Pacific plate. That's why I'm warning my viewers in Japan. That's why we're going to be warning the people over in Mexico coming soon in just a little bit. Now, on the west coast of the U.S., let me recap one more time. We're looking for 6.0 activity to be striking right where the 4.0 just hit, right down to the point. And I mean, look where it hit. That is our warned area. And the warned area just got hit. So it's a magnitude and a half less than what I'm looking for right now. I suppose that's good news. But we're looking for it to go up to 6. Already, add that in with the other 4s that hit, and it looks like Southern California is due. Also, it looks like the Midwest is due at the fracking operations. The 4.0s over the past several days show it to us. Okay, so do not ignore the warning signs. We've seen 4s take down chimneys and knock facades off houses in Oklahoma at the start of 2016. 4.3 earthquake did that. Now, here we are. It looks like it's coming again. Now, I hope there's no damage, and I hope people are not caught off guard. And I hope people watch the forecast that I issued for this week, issued on Tuesday. But I can hope all day long. Do you have an earthquake plan? Do you know what to do when an earthquake strikes? Now, if it's a 4 or 5.0 earthquake and you're in a frame structure of any kind or a big high-rise skyscraper building, a 4 or 5 hits, you probably want to maybe get the loose items and maybe secure them or let them fall. And if you really need to, you can get underneath a desk or a table to protect yourself from anything that could be falling that might be loose up above. So that's in those 4 and 5.0 earthquakes. But once you get right beyond the 5.0 level, if you're in a brick structure, if you're in a cinder block structure, poured concrete, even if it's reinforced with rebar, if you're in one of those kind of buildings and you're in something that feels like pretty intense shaking, you need to have an exit plan from the building, not just under a doorway, not just under a table, but an exit plan. Because above 5.0 activity, it's all about force and power. So it can be upper 4 could be the same as a 5.5, depending on the depth of it and the shaking intensity. Again, at the shallow depth causes major shaking. Okay, so just take those things into account, and then you can have a plan. 1, shelter in place for smaller earthquakes. 2, exit the structure. Right? This is no-brainer stuff. But when you're exiting the structure, you better have some, organization to the way you're going to do it. Don't scream earthquake and just run outside. you need to know what's outside that could fall and hit you. You're playing dodgeball with things outside that you might not be aware of high above, right? And also, if you're going to be running outside, you might want to think about having what we call a preparation bag, or here in the States, slang term, bug out bag. You might need a bug out bag for when you're bugging out. Now, it doesn't need to be loaded with all kinds of crazy. I'm just talking about an ID, if you have insurance, an extra copy of the insurance card, extra set of keys maybe, right, to get in the car if you got a car, or maybe a way to, a form of communication, an extra cell phone or charger or both. Just those things that you could maybe put into a bag that would help you. First aid kit, band-aids. Man, they can come in handy. You get cut with glass. See, here's the thing. Here's my biggest worry. Now, I've never been in a large earthquake. I've never really even felt an earthquake. Well, it's borderline, but well, we won't go there. But I have this worry that I'm going to be in bed when the earthquake that, you know, is due here at the New Madrid hits in Missouri, here in the central United States. And it will someday. Or it'll hit in Oklahoma and we'll still feel it. But my worry is that I'm in bed and I've got, you know, my socks off and my shoes off and things are shaking and I don't feel it for the first several seconds that it's happening. And by the time I do feel it, it's 10, 20, 30 seconds into the event and things are really shaking. And then I'm getting out of bed and my shoes aren't there. And there's broken glass on the floor. And all of a sudden, it's like Bruce Willis in Die Hard. Right? Okay, so you don't want glass all over the floor from something, just a mirror even, or a picture frame that falls and breaks, or a dish falls out of the cabinet and breaks, and you're walking across that, or running across it, depending on how big the earthquake is, trying to get out, right? So a little prep ahead of time, set of shoes or slippers by the bed, could make all the difference in a disaster like that. Just little things. You already got a set of shoes, right? You would just put them by the bed and make sure that you can grab them on the way out. Same thing with the bug out bag. You might want to think about your environment. You know, it's getting to be winter, getting to get colder out now. Well, if an earthquake hits in the winter here in the Midwest, Oklahoma, Kansas, Missouri, even Texas, Arkansas, Illinois, hits in the middle of winter, you're going to need a set of clothes, right? You're going to need a blanket. You're going to need those things. So think about them ahead of time. They're all things that you already have. It's just something that you need to have in a little bag that you can grab and go out the door. That's my advice to you. So bug out bag, shelter in place for smaller earthquakes, exit the structure for any major event. And you'll be 100 times better off than your next door neighbor or the people down the street who haven't thought about it at all and are caught off guard. Now here's the third part of all this. You know, the first part is just being aware, right? Second part is having a plan, and the third part is being prepared. Now, being prepared is many different aspects. I like to consider it being prepared, knowing what's coming your way. I watch the weather. You guys all watch the weather, too. Whether you tune in on nightly news and get it from your local meteorologist, or some of you are real weather nerds, and you guys have your apps and your websites that you go to all day long, you watch the radar and watch the storms come at you from the West Coast. Here in the United States, our storms come from the West and go to the East for the most part. Okay, there's been some weird examples in the South that, you know, maybe have contradicted that, but for the most part, West to East. So we watch our storms come from West to East. Well, good news, guys. You can watch seismic storms the same way. You can watch them come from the West and press to the East. Over in Europe, you can watch your pressure transfer from the east to the west and watch it like storms blowing across the Mediterranean. It's kind of ironic that the seismic flow follows somewhat of our weather flow, wouldn't you say? And we'll leave it right there at that. Maybe we can touch on that at a later date. Do you guys also, again, I need to issue a correction, sorry, before we go. Look, guys, last night I had a report to me that there was solar activity that was taking place. That came from Tattooed, a trusted source of mine. And I didn't bother to check any solar charts or look at any solar events. So that came to me from Tattooed, and I think he was looking at a sun-diving comet and some other stuff that was going on, and there was a misrelay to me. He said solar activity. He corrected himself today. He said, no, there's no solar activity, or if there is, it's not a flare. So no solar activity that I know of coming at us, except for a coronal hole, which is somewhat regular. Just that's a slight correction to last night's update. So if any solar activity does take place, we will check that. And there is one other thing. We need to check. Let's see. Mimic TPW. There we go. Now look at this. Check this out. Watch this. Let me get a different view. Now, the Mimic TPW shows us total precipitable water derived from microwave background imagery. Now, this is not designed to show any kind of, man-made system, and it's not normally designed to show any natural phenomenon like solar flares or CMEs, coronal mass ejections, filament ruptures that come towards Earth from the sun. Those show up on here sometimes. But what you're going to see here is a waveform. Well, it's projecting out from Antarctica. And its first blast goes right across over to Hawaii. Watch it. And it's actually a corkscrew shape. You have to look at this three-dimensionally, even though we're on a 2D map. You have to look at this as a waveform. It's a 3D waveform, and it takes several hours for it to do whatever it's doing. So it's not just one zap over a second. This is over many hours, so maybe 8 or 12 hours where that's going across. And then the second pulse, if you will, coming out of Antarctica, goes right up into Southern California and the Southern United States. Now, I went down and just, curious. I didn't go there personally, but I went down on Google Earth to see if there was anything of any significance that was in the same location where these pulses were coming from. And it just so happens to be that this is the, there's several U.S. and other installations that are down here. Now, they don't have them marked on Google Earth. You actually have to go look them up online and then find them here and manually do the tracking, like type in the coordinates. So, I'm sure they probably have some of these marked, but that's where it's coming from. It's coming from down here. So, what can we say? I don't know what to make of it. Let me put it that way. We've seen all kinds of stuff on here before, and I've even seen these pulses coming from up in Alaska. Now, you guys know what's up in Alaska, don't you? The High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program, which is commonly called HARP, and it's a giant radio transmitter, a radio wave transmitter, huge antennas that broadcast high frequency that heats the atmosphere. It actually will cause air glow. They can cause lightning. They can control the weather with it. In the Air Force weather weapon modification documents we found, there's talk of using it on the battlefield to deny precipitation or to make it rain on the battlefield or to remove fog or create fog, direct lightning. That was experiments done, and direct fire. See, that's the crazy thing, is that in 2014 and 2015, HARP got funding to do radio wave experiments on the controlling of fire using radio waves from HARP. Now, I don't know how that would work, but it was done under DARPA, D-A-R-P-A, and the U.S. Navy and U.S. Air Force, all three partnered together to do this fire and lightning control series of experiments from HARP. Now, controlling fire, the only way you could have fire is at ground level, pretty much. What are they going to do, make fire in the atmosphere and control it? So I've got some questions as to what we're looking at here and what we might see as a result of it. The only thing I could tell you is that we have to pay attention. Look where it's zapping into: Hawaii and Southern California into Mexico. Well, watch those two spots, of course. Right? And if nothing happens, then, of course, nothing happens, and that's good. But it's a lot of energy, and energy can transform. Energy like radio waves gets converted. Now, you're not going to believe this, but I guarantee you it's true. Radio waves convert into DC energy, the same kind of power that powers your circuit board. But how does that happen? Mother Nature absorbs the radio waves, alternating current, and in a process called efficiency scaling, converts it to DC once those AC signals get trapped by Mother Nature's magnetic fields. So the magnetic fields around Earth capture radio waves. You know what? There's, and this is very strange too. Unless it's a high power targeted radio wave, most of the radio waves don't escape from Earth's atmosphere. You know, there's a common folklore that that the World War II broadcast from the Nazis or something at the Olympics is broadcasting out there into space and that aliens are going to hear it someday. Well, guys, I hate to break it to you, but it may not have even broken through the magnetosphere. And that's good news for us. I shouldn't say I hate to break it to you. I guess we should be happy that it wasn't powerful enough or targeted to be going up and out of the Earth's magnetosphere, like a targeted, powerful satellite microwave signal that they're using to target out into space, for instance, or low frequency that's used to speak even further out into space. So VLF being used for long distance communication and VHF, UHF being used for short range communication to satellites in low Earth orbit. Now, I know I'm getting real technical here, but all that energy, all those radio waves that don't leave Earth or are on ground level get absorbed by Earth and taken down to the core of the Earth. And guess what? The core of the Earth is a giant electroplasma torch, not a solid ball of metal. Now, it has mass. It has weight to it even. Plasma has weight, and it's rotating. Now, it would be called oscillating because it's electrical. But think of a lightning bolt, only much bigger. Ball lightning, only much bigger and much more powerful. Hot enough to melt any element. And it's down at the core of the Earth. And it's powered by electricity provided from the sun. Now, how does the sun get electricity to the core of the Earth? It sends charged particles to Earth on a daily basis that skim across the upper magnetosphere and atmosphere in some cases, depending on what's going on. But when those charged particles skim across the Earth's magnetosphere, think of yourself scuffing your feet across the carpet and touching something and shocking yourself, and that electron discharge comes out of your body. Your body stores that up like a capacitor. Okay, so you're scuffing your feet across the carpet, you're basically becoming a little battery. You're holding that charge in. Then you get across the room, you touch the doorknob, and out comes the power that you just built up. Now, when you were scuffing your feet across the carpet, you were pulling small electrons off the carpet, and it's going into your body, and you're absorbing it and keeping it in there just for a short time. Now, these particles, when they're flying very fast, 600, 500 kilometers a second, they're invisible, but they pass across the atmosphere and they build up an invisible electron charge. Now, when a whole bunch of them come in, it builds up so much charge that the air starts to glow up in the upper ionosphere and you get something called the northern lights and southern lights. Now, those northern lights and southern lights, the aurora borealis, those lights are very, very powerful electrical charge. And all that energy goes down into the core of the Earth. We call it ground. When you plug something in, you've got ground. Lightning, you know, a lightning rod takes it to ground, takes the electricity to ground. Well, ground goes into the dirt. The dirt goes down into the crust. The crust goes down into the magma. The magma goes down through the mantle, and the mantle goes down to the core. And all that power goes down to that core. And it's, of course, spinning, rotating, and heating. And the more power that goes to the core, it's just like turning up the dial on an electroplasma torch in a factory, only much more powerful. So, that's what's going on. There's a core of the Earth issue that's causing an expansion that's spreading across the entire planet. I hope I've explained myself thoroughly on this. Now, I've gone way, way, way beyond what I was hoping to talk about. I love talking about this stuff. Love it. It really intrigues me. And someday, we will prove some aspect of the plasma core. And right now, scientists believe it's a solid ball of metal. You know why? Because waves reflected off of it like it was solid. So seismic waves bounce off of it, and earth-penetrating tomography, radio waves, VLF, bounces off of it. Now, scientists, I don't blame them, thought that meant it was solid. I mean, it's reflecting off. It waves are passing through it like it's a solid. Okay. Well, unfortunately, they didn't know what the U.S. Navy and U.S. Air Force and DARPA and the others were doing up here at HARP was going to change all of modern-day science. That they found that the plasma, and again, I'm getting very, very technical here, but that the electron cascade, that the plasma that forms reflects radio waves. It reflects any kind of wave. Boeing has now patented an electric arc plasma, basically force field. Now, they don't call it a force field. They call it something else. But it generates an electrical arc away from a Humvee tank or building. They've already patented this. And the electrical arc they have found reflects shock waves from explosions. Not radio waves like up in the atmosphere that they found at HARP with the U.S. Air Force. But that at ground level, an electrical arc, basically a lightning bolt, will reflect shock waves. Now, it doesn't stop the flying shrapnel, but it will stop that blast that sends the car flying over. Now, if a human-generated plasma, electrical lightning bolt, basically, will stop a shockwave from an explosion, imagine what Mother Nature's plasma core is reflecting. It's reflecting whole earthquakes off of it. And, of course, earth-penetrating tomography and any radio wave that humans can generate reflect off of it like it's a solid. Something very hot is down at the core of the Earth, not something solid and cold. Dirt? Come on. Okay? So, now you understand. And I love talking about this. I could go on for hours. The class that I teach here is one that's in alternate science. We are confronting many different aspects of what people would consider accepted orthodox science. I am unorthodox. Oh boy, I hope you like what I'm doing here. If you really like what I'm doing here, there is a link down below to my fundraiser. I'm trying to reach a goal for the year. We're already, I think, well, almost 40% into the goal, and we're 3 days in on the fundraiser. Once it hits the goal, of course, I will turn it off. I could let it go further, but we're going to, again, just set it at what we're needing, which is we're trying to get it to $1,000 a month for the next 12 months. For my salary here online. And that's just the way we do it. Of course, I could take sponsors. Well, you guys know we got offered a huge sponsorship from a hedge fund that I think might still be willing to help. I'd have to contact them and see if they'd still willing. But they offered major financing in the tune of whatever we need kind of financing. But I turned that down for a couple different reasons. One of which is I like to be this grassroots supported by my viewers person for several reasons. I don't have to be beholden to anybody. I don't have to sell anything. I don't have to do any kind of, you know, special promotions to get my stuff out there. It's between you and me, the viewer. If you like what I do, there is a link down below to that. Also, there is Patreon. That's an option. $1 a month or something, right? And then YouTube will pay me if you'll watch my videos. So if people will watch my videos, YouTube will pay me, or we have Patreon, or we have the fundraiser. We have many options set up. I appreciate everyone who's taken their time to share my information. It has gone around the world. I mean, I love using this example because I know that it's an example that someone's life has been altered and changed for the better because of the forecast that we're issuing. Over in Italy last year, we issued a warning the day before the big one hit. It was the biggest earthquake in 40 years. Now, the day before the earthquake hit, there was a deep earthquake in Italy. I got on, issued the warning, told people that it was coming within the next 48 to 72 hours, and it was going to be around 7.0. The next day, 6.8 hit, or whatever, 6.4. Biggest earthquake in 40 years. And the people there got the warning the day before, and they listened.
One person in particular, a UK citizen who lives over there in Italy, went around town and told people, and told the mayor. The next day, when the earthquake hit, they were already downstairs in their stone house, sleeping by the door, waiting to go. Many people were. Then, after it hit, guess what? No one died. Now, there was an earthquake a few months before that was less. It was in the 6th range, and hundreds of people died because nobody got my warning for that one, which we also issued a warning for the 2 days before, and nobody got the warning. The video only has, it still only has a few thousand views. So the second warning they did get, then a miracle happened. They took to BBC News and thanked me publicly on BBC twice or thrice. I think it was three times. May have been twice recorded and three times they mentioned me. And they mentioned you guys too. dutchsinse and his viewers got the warning out to Italy. Now, I did my part. I put the video out. I put my neck on the line. If I'm wrong, people come back to beat me up. If I'm right, they come back not to give me credit. So either way, my neck's on the line. But again, you guys did your part to get it over to Italy, because I don't know anybody there, and I don't speak Italian. So they got the warning, and it mattered. People actually were, their injury was averted. The person who evacuated their house, the UK citizen who took to the news to thank me, their whole house broke apart, basically. Or at least a good wall of it completely broke apart. All the other buildings around, you know, just to the south, I think by like 20 miles south, were destroyed. Maybe it was to the north. Either or. I mean, close by. So, you guys have made a huge, huge difference. Me on my own, I could have never done it. So, thank you. And I'm going to save this as a video on my YouTube channel now so people can watch it in the future. And I'd feel very proud if you would share it to your friends, family, loved ones, coworkers. And if anything else changes, or if I get it wrong, if I issue a forecast for an area and it doesn't get hit, I do something that the weatherman and weatherwoman, meteorologist, never do. I come back and correct myself publicly and try to figure out why I got it wrong, and I go over it with you guys too. Like, we try to collectively figure out where did the energy go, where, why didn't it hit, and so forth. That to me is really, it's one of the more fun things of doing this, because it's like I get to come in and we get to do some real investigative work to try and figure out where it went.